Okay, first of all, let me thank you for your patience as we shuffled around. The good news is there's a lot more of you than we expected tonight, so thank you. We really do appreciate that. I also, before we get started tonight, want to introduce some special guests that are here. Please welcome our mayor, Matt Powell. Council member Lowell Moore. I also saw County Commissioner Cynthia Long. And our former mayor, Bob Lemon. My name is Penny Ewell, and I work at the city manager's office here at the city of Cedar Park. And again, welcome to each and every one of you. We sincerely appreciate you sharing a portion of your evening with us here tonight. We're going to take approximately 45 minutes to an hour, and we promise to do our very best to make this all well worth your while. We are here to unveil the draft of our new comprehensive plan. The comprehensive plan is the blueprint for how Cedar Park will look and feel over the next 20 years. It's the blueprint that guides our leaders and our decision makers towards sensible, responsible growth that's in line with the community's vision. About 14 months ago, we started some pretty intensive public input that included a website called Imagine Cedar Park, as well as some town meetings, focus groups, and through a community steering committee. Now, that portion of the input gathering and analysis is complete, and that has all been included in our draft plan. So, while the actual comprehensive plan, and I don't know if you saw the drafts in the back, it's a pretty big technical document, and it's full of public input, but we're excited this evening to share with you what we think is a pretty good high-level overview of that document, including what it means to the city of Cedar Park and what it means to each of you. Also, you'll see around the room and in the back, and we marched them over here, some very specific goals and objectives, as well as some very detailed maps. So if you haven't had a chance to look at those at the end of the evening, we'll invite you to walk around and look at those poster boards. During our presentation, we want to share our journey with you. So we've broken it down into three encompassing components, and we will introduce you to some fictional Cedar Park families. They are representative of the community outreach and the feedback groups that we talk to during our outreach portion. We even think that you may recognize yourselves in some of our fictional families. I will be serving as your facilitator and moderator this evening. That means I get to do what I do at work pretty much every day, and that's keeping things on track and moving along. So here's how things are going to go this evening. First of all, because your feedback is so important to us, and because we don't want to miss anything, and we know time is really of the essence this evening, instead of the traditional Q&A session from the floor, we're going to pause between each speaker and ask you to fill out a survey. And we'll be filling out the survey portion for just that section that we heard about. Also, we'd like to have your name at the top, maybe the neighborhood that you're from, and how you heard about this meeting. Was it social media? Did you get a personal invite? Did you lose a bet? You know, whatever brought you here this evening, we'd like to know. Okay, now, let's see. I'm going to be back to talk to you again about the surveys some more this evening. First of all, does anyone still need a survey? We need one here. And does anybody need, we need one back there, Garrett. If you keep your hands up so that our survey delivery people can find you. And does anybody need a pen? We might have a few extra pens kicking around here somewhere too. Also, at the end of the evening, we're going to be holding a raffle for an exciting, beautiful, brand new iPod Shuffle. So, does everyone have a raffle ticket for the iPod Shuffle? Does anyone need a raffle ticket? Everyone's got their raffle ticket. All right, that's fabulous. They tell me that the iPod Shuffle is really good for runners. And I say, if you ever see me running, you better start running too, because it means something's really big's chasing me down the road. Okay, when we get to the end of the evening and start wrapping things up, those of you that need to scoot out the door may certainly do so. Those of you that still have a question or, you know, want to have some conversation with one of our speakers or one of our staff members are certainly welcome to stay and do that at the end of the evening. Can I have my City of Cedar Park staff members raise your hand so they know who they're looking for? All right. Thank you very much. Okay. Let's get started. The first person I'd like to introduce tonight, most of you are probably familiar with. She is just returning from a pleasure trip. That's right. She dropped her kids off at summer camp. I've had the privilege of working with her here at the city for quite some time now, and she's done a phenomenal job of steering the city through some tremendous growth. She is my city manager and yours, Brenda Evans.
Good evening, and I'll say it again, it is so nice to have expectations exceeded and then some. So I appreciate y'all's patience as we sort of had to relocate us into this facility and welcome you here into what are our city council chambers. So with that, I'll tell you a little about myself. As Penny mentioned, I'm city manager here. I actually started working for the city almost 19 years ago. And at that time, I was the Human Resources Director, and I've been the city manager here for about 9 years. It has been an incredible 2 decades. I mean, I can't imagine, honestly, a more exciting place to be than Cedar Park, and I will tell you, I feel blessed and busy every single day. My husband Scott and I moved here in 1996. We built our first home in Carriage Hills, as a matter of fact. And when we built this home, we had no kids, no dog. I don't even think we had a fence in our backyard at that time. But here we are, some time later, and we've sold that home and live in our second home here in Cedar Park. And in fact, we do have a fence because we do have a dog. And we do have 2 children, one who will go into 5th grade, who truly is at summer camp right now. And I'm going to tell you, my heart is aching just a little bit. And the other one is at that fabulous age called 8th grader. For those of you who have, I don't know. So when we talk about Cedar Park tonight, I'm going to ask you to think about a word. And that word is place. And I don't want you to think about the verb necessarily to put, but I want you to think about the noun, place, location. So as we talk about Cedar Park and our comp plan, and I know why you're here is because you're interested in, gosh, what did people say about our future? What does the comp plan look like? Because it's our community's voice and input, and that's your voice, that really does help determine the future of Cedar Park. So with that, I will say, good things do come to those who plan. And I'm gonna take you back a little ways, and we're gonna call it the 1970s. Who was here during the 1970s? I know there were a few of you. Where's the Willises? Yes, there you go. 1970s. And during that time, we had Elton John, who was singing about a rockin' crocodile, and we had Tony Orlando and Don, who were tying yellow ribbons around oak trees. And a little closer to home, we had a popularity of Austin that was really driving growth, both in the size of the city as well as the number of people coming into this region. And the folks in our community of Cedar Park took a look around because they saw an ever-expanding Austin. And they said, gosh, we have a strong belief that the destiny and future of Cedar Park will be better served by people in our community. So in 1973, our residents went to the polls and they took a vote, and Cedar Park became an official city with its own governance and its own city council. And this first city council had many important things to do, like create a police department, make sure that the volunteer fire department was here to serve. They looked at securing water for our future. But they also did something else. They applied the first zoning in Cedar Park. So what's zoning, you may ask? Well, zoning is a planning tool that's used by a city that looks at a piece of property and it applies a land use designation. So permitted uses that can go on this land, as well as the standards for development for whatever's constructed there. So you can think of it like areas where you have single family housing developments and there are certain lot sizes and standards, or retail areas, and are they big retail sites, are they smaller ones that just serve the neighborhoods? And that's what they looked at. Tonight, I'll tell you, however, we're really here to look at the bigger picture. We're not really here to talk about the very specific zoning designations of individual properties, but rather the broader look, the broader vision for development in Cedar Park for the future. Penny's already mentioned the comp plan. That's what we call it. It's really the comprehensive plan, but you'll hear us say comp plan tonight because that gets to be a mouthful. And she described what it is. And I'll say a comp plan is in short, it's a document where the community describes what it wants its city to be and look and feel like in the future. Now, what it also does is that it'll look at infrastructure such as water and wastewater and roads, those things that are necessary to serve the city, along with other city services that we provide, like public safety. And it'll also include areas that when we do this community outreach and our public talks about things that are other things that are important to them, you'll find those in our document. Ideas like community identity, economic development, parks and open space. So those are sort of the components that you'll find in that big document Penny talked about. But let's fast forward from 1973, about 25 years, to 1998. Many of you here in 98? Yes? 1998, I'd been here for 2 years, and Cedar Park was truly in the middle of explosive growth. We were named the fourth fastest growing city in the nation. And instead of a few hundred people, our population was about 20,000. During that time, our community leaders and our community members were in the middle of a really big planning effort, and that was the Comprehensive Plan, 1998. And I see some faces of people out here who I know were here and who were part of that discussion and those decisions that were made during that time. Were there big ideas in that 1998 plan? Absolutely, there were. People came out and they talked about what they loved about Cedar Park and what they thought Cedar Park would be in the future, 15 to 20 years from then, which is really right now. And what they said is, we want an attractive place to be. We want Cedar Park to continue to be that place that's family-focused, family-oriented, and gosh, we want to see some other things too. So that plan really looked at and focused on ideas like a sense of place, maybe a downtown, connection points, ways for our community members to be connected, a plan for Bell Boulevard, which is also known as 183, good transportation routes. They wanted more places for shopping and dining and entertaining. They wanted a hospital in our community. And I see Maria Talamo here, who's like, yes, yes. And they wanted places for our kids to play. In essence, what they said is, you know what? We don't want to be known only as a bedroom community to the city of Austin. We want to become our own. And they called it creating a full-service city. So here we are today. And I'd say, out of all those things that I listed, how many of those things have you seen come to fruition? And it's quite a few of them. Do you still consider Cedar Park just a bedroom community? We've still had continued growth over these last 15 years. We were named the third best small city to move to this last year. And I think a lot of people got that memo, right? Yeah. We will also get the designation of being the fourth fastest growing city in the nation again. This time, it's not 20,000. We have a population that's over 60,000 that are inside our city limits and our borders that you can see up there. And we have about another 20,000 people that live just outside of our city limits. Unlike other cities around us, though, Cedar Park is landlocked. We have Austin to our south. We have Leander to our north. We have Round Rock to our east. And we have Preserve and the city of Jonestown to our west. Cedar Park won't physically grow much outside the current borders that you see up there. That being said, we are still planning for additional population growth, and we expect our total population to be somewhere around 100,000, maybe slightly larger in the future, and we'll do that through, again, new development or through annexation. So what do the next 15 to 20 years look like based on the input that we got through the community outreach? What kind of place will Cedar Park be to live or work or visit? And why does it matter? Well, I'll tell you, for me, looking out 15 years, I mentioned my kids earlier, and I am making an assumption, but in 15 years, I'm assuming they are going to not live with me anymore, okay? But I ask myself, if they've stayed in this community for this time period, will they still want to be here in 15 years? And if they've left for some reason, will they want to come back? Will Cedar Park continue to be a desirable place? I'd say that the community vision upon which the comprehensive plan is based really does reinforce this idea of being a desirable place, and then some. And I'm going to read what that vision says. We imagine the city of Cedar Park as a family-oriented, attractive destination, and a leader in business development that's committed to an exceptional quality of life. This vision was developed and adopted by our community steering committee for the comp plan. And I bet you wouldn't be surprised if you look up here, Mauro's going to show us some of the statements that came from those community input meetings that Penny talked about earlier. They talk about distinctive character and being family oriented with gathering places, exploring industries for job growth, considering our designs for development. And that's just a sample of what we heard. But from that, what you'll find in the comp plan are some of these overarching ideas and themes that are present within the comp plan, such as the areas of development that are concentrated that create vibrant districts, walkable and connected environments. Again, areas where we can explore to generate new job growth. And looking at city services and infrastructure to meet the demands of the future. So to repeat, the comprehensive plan is a culmination of all of this input, and it is looking at the city's future. We do have a diverse community. There's a lot of interest out there, y'all. And so with that, Penny mentioned some of the fictional families that represent some of the demographics that we heard from, and I'm going to introduce those to you just real quickly. First, we have the Butterfields. We call the Butterfields our empty nesters. One day, I want to be a Butterfield. The Butterfields moved here because they wanted to raise their family here. They wanted to find an affordable home in a nice community with good schools. But their children are grown now, and they've left their homes. And the Butterfields enjoy a life with their grandchildren nearby, and they're involved in the community in a lot of different ways, through their neighborhood, through their church. They get to watch their grandkids in youth sports. We also have the Woods. Now, the Woods represent a typical family when you look at our demographics. They've got three children, they're a young family, but they also represent that part of our demographic who works in Cedar Park as well. Mrs. Wood is actually the CEO of a high-tech company that was born and developed right here in Cedar Park. It now employs over 100 people. They're an important part of not only today's fabric, but our future fabric related to how we keep people in our community so they don't have to commute. Mr. Woods, he works in our community as well. We also have Mario. He's our young professional. He lives in the townhomes in the Cedar Park Town Center. He's a sales consultant, and he loves his dog, Cricket. And then finally, we heard from a younger demographic in our community, as represented here by Alex and Hannah and Ryan. They're high schoolers, and I learned they represent both Cedar Park and Vista Ridge. So good things do come to those who plan. And so with that, we want to talk to you tonight about the big ideas for future land use and development, about the livability in Cedar Park, and finally about how we're going to get around with some transportation planning. With that, I'm going to turn this over to Catherine Warner, who's going to talk to us about big ideas. Catherine?
Hi, I'm Catherine Warner. I am the Director of Community Affairs here at the city. And when we were divvying up topics, I was like, big ideas? Yeah, that's what I want to be responsible for. But I'm going to kind of tell you a little bit about what goes into that section. I've been in Cedar Park for 7 years, so not quite as long as Brenda, but probably a little bit longer than the gentleman I was sitting next to who came in March, you said? So, but in those 7 years, I have seen quite a bit of growth and development. When I first came here, a lot of the discussion was about all the new neighborhoods that were coming online. We saw development in the Ranch of Brushy Creek, Whitestone Oaks, Caballo Ranch, probably a lot of places you all call home now. I then also remember when 1890 Ranch opened and the Target opened, and all of a sudden Cedar Park had numerous national retailers here in our borders. And then, of course, I'd be remiss to not mention when the Cedar Park Center opened, and all of a sudden we had sports and real entertainment acts. Last night I went to the John Legend concert, and I am continually amazed at the level of acts that are being brought into the center. Now, those things started as big ideas. Brenda talked to you about that 1998 comp plan and how that was when some new things were kind of come up with from the community. So now we're kind of entering that next phase. We're asking the question, what else would make living, working, and playing here even more fulfilling, even more enjoyable? What else do people want to see? So one of the things we talk about in a comprehensive plan, which Brenda told you is a pretty technical document, and you are welcome to read all 160 pages later if you'd like, but it's really about long-range planning. It's about that big picture. And so one of the tools in which we tackle that topic is through future land use. Brenda talked a little bit about zoning, which is a little bit more on a specific base. So this is more broad picture. How do we want the community to look and feel in the future? Part of that also is compatibility. That's something that our planners think about and decision makers as they're deciding what's going to go where. So in your neighborhood, in the right in the middle of it, you probably don't have a giant Target. And that kind of goes into that issue of compatibility. I would also tell you that the future land use plan is not a rigid prescription. It doesn't tell you everything to do. It's really more of a guide for future decision makers. So, this section of the plan is big ideas. It is what did the community tell us they'd like to see here, and then where are we going to put it? And so we'll kind of talk about that. So really, it is missing places, which is what are the things that you all told us I'd love to see that here, and then those key locations. And together, that forms this concept of big ideas. So before I get into that, it's really important for me to tell you to keep in mind that when we talk about locations, this land is privately owned. So as much as we can all get into the idea of we should put that there and this here, it's really about working with landowners, working with them to find something that meets the community's need, is compatible with the surrounding area, and is really a benefit to everybody involved. So keep that in mind as we start looking especially at locations. So first, let's talk about some of those things that you all told us you'd like to see us work on to come to our community. The first one we heard a lot about is entertainment. Brenda mentioned some of those families, like the Wood family, which is kind of that classic Cedar Park family with some young kids who are looking for things to do with their family. So we heard a big desire from people for more entertainment and family-friendly destination activities. So that could include things like large-scale arcades, game centers, movie theaters, performance art venues, community theaters, museums. The list goes on and on. But it's basically somewhere to go with your family for a fun day. It also is something that is destination worthy. So it may be something that people actually come to from outside of the community, or if you have people visiting, they would want to go there. So it's something that really is special to the community. The next thing that we saw a lot of interest from people on was getting to work here, having more employment centers. So obviously I get to work and live in Cedar Park, but who here works in Cedar Park, whether you'd be working from home or an office? Okay. That is probably a larger number than we saw a few years ago. Now, who wishes they could work here and have less of a commute? Okay, I expected more hands than that. You guys must be loving some traffic, which Garrett will be talking to you about a little bit later. But we do hear that frequently from people. I'd like to see more employment centers. And so one of the main goals in that comp plan is to create more business parks. And those can come in a whole variety of shapes and sizes. But it's bringing more employers here that not only maybe are related to that high-tech field, which Austin is so known for, or other type of innovative industries, but we also see a benefit from these business parks for kind of what I would call secondary or supporting businesses. So when you think about large business parks or business campuses, they have places to go eat lunch. They have dry cleaners. They have gyms. They have all sorts of kind of supplemental things around them. And that provides a lot of opportunities for our community's small business owners to take part in that as well. So we see business parks coming, and we're not envisioning just cold concrete office buildings. We want them to be something that is walkable, aesthetically pleasing, an enjoyable place, something that really enhances the community. We obviously see a lot of potential for many of our residents to want to take part in this. Not only families like the parents, like the Woods or Mario, our young professional, but really we see a lot of people that will want to take part in this. The next missing place we heard about was one that was kind of new, and that is a higher education campus, whether it be a branch or a satellite or its own institution on its own. I usually get in trouble for being too loud, so I would have surely thought projecting. The ACC campus on Cypress Creek Road has contributed so much to our community through the years. And we've seen a real interest from the community in kind of growing whatever higher education may look like in our community. So we see potential to perhaps marry the concepts of uniting high-tech employers with higher ed. You know, we're open to exploring those ideas. There's also quite a few benefits that we see coming from bringing more higher educational opportunities to our community. First, we think it provides good opportunities for our existing workforce to become even more skilled, or for employers, it provides them a base for that skilled workforce. We also see it as a focal point for other development. Development likes to be around things that are vibrant and thriving, and college campuses can definitely be that. We also see it as a place to provide certification courses, perhaps, for citizens. And of course, you know, we talked a little bit about that important demographic, which are our youth. And we talked about Alex, Ryan, and Hannah, who go to Vista Ridge or Cedar Park High, depending on what part of town you're from. But providing them an opportunity to stay in the community after graduation and continue being here and thriving and becoming members of Cedar Park's future. The fourth missing place I want to mention is what we're calling walkable mixed use. It is in something we frequently hear is, I wish we had something like the Domain here. So it's that concept of a place where you park once, and then you have multiple places to go and multiple entertainment opportunities. So there's places to eat, there's places to shop, there's places for entertainment. There may be some type of unique residential product involved with that. But it's something that, you know, provides entertainment and date night activities was something we actually frequently saw on that Imagine Cedar Park website. People would write, I want a date night activity. I want somewhere to go
for adult type things that also appeals to other groups. So this idea of walkable mixed use, we actually see it appealing to everyone in our community. We think everyone can find things there. For our youth, not only do we see them wanting a gathering place that is a safe place for them to go, but we also hear that they want places to get that first job. And so there's retail and plenty of busing table opportunities in that for everybody to earn their first minimum wage job. So anyways, I say that kind of in jest, but we see a lot of benefit from this walkable mixed use type development. Finally, I would be remiss to not mention housing at all. You'll notice none of these ideas really directly relate to a single family neighborhood. And when you think about Cedar Park, we have so many wonderful single-family neighborhoods. And as we look at kind of reaching build-out in that next phase, we don't foresee that many more single-family neighborhoods coming online. We do see a limited number of medium and high-density housing, so think lofts and townhome-type product, if it's part of another development where that makes sense. So thinking again about that walkable mixed use concept, having a residential component kind of feels right for that. And then we also see an opportunity and a need for large lot executive housing. So when there's opportunities for that, I think we'll want to take advantage of it. So if you think about all of those things, you're probably thinking, where are we going to put all that? Cedar Park has grown so much. Where is there to put it? And that's what brings us to those key locations. Cedar Park, as Brenda talked about, is landlocked, which again means that we don't have wide, vast tracts of undeveloped land necessarily that we can take advantage of that isn't currently in our city limits. So within the comprehensive plan, we did identify some of these key areas. And I'm not going to go into a ton of detail on them all, but I will point some of them out. The first one you'll notice at the north side is called PAB. I told you it was a technical document. That stands for Planning Area B. It is near the Cedar Park Center, so it's that kind of, you know, that chunk of land right there. You'll also see towards the east side, along Palmer Lane, three separate tracks that we foresee development going in the future. The Palmer Lane is becoming much more of a north-south corridor for our community, so we do see growth going there. And then I'd like to mention PAC, which I always kind of forget when I drive by, but it's on Brushy Creek right by Gupton Stadium, and it is also another large tract of undeveloped land. Also, as Cedar Park last year celebrated its 40th birthday, we are entering the phase of beginning to explore redevelopment. So there are two tracks that are actually, we think, prime for redevelopment, perhaps now or in the future. The first one on the west, PAA, is currently operating as a limestone quarry. We see opportunities there in the future to do something with it. It has a lot of neat topographical kind of features since it is a quarry, but it also has some challenges because it's a quarry. So, you know, it'll be interesting to see what comes of that. And then, of course, we should talk about the Bell Corridor. Brenda mentioned that came up in 1998. And really, if you think about Bell Boulevard, it is the backbone of Cedar Park. And it is an area that we frequently hear from people as something that they think needs to get some TLC. And so that is becoming a big focus for us to look at redevelopment there. We think that is a prime spot for this because we've also heard from the community you'd like to see a greater sense of identity, a greater sense of unique place, something that tells you you're in Cedar Park and that's different. And Bell Boulevard goes all the way back to 1973. Garrett's going to show you some really interesting pictures from the 70s of it. So it has a lot of that kind of unique character already there, and we see some opportunities to take that and maybe grow some of that. So that is an area we'll be focusing on. Of course, you can't talk about 183 and not mention mobility. Obviously, we've seen traffic volumes on that road greatly increase as our population and the population north of us has increased. So that's something that we're very mindful of. So really big ideas is what we heard from the community as to what you wanted to see here. So it's that entertainment destination type of activity. It is more business and employment opportunities. It is a higher education campus, and then that kind of walkable mixed use, which has a lot of opportunities. So it's taking that as like, okay, that's our new to-do list to work on. And then when there are opportunities on what we think these developments would need larger areas, we want to try to marry those together. So with that, I'm going to hand it back to Penny.
Thank you, Kat. Her presentation always reminds me of an Oliver Wendell Holmes quote, and that is, "One's mind, once stretched by a new idea, never regains its original dimension." I like that one. Okay, guess what? It's survey time. So we would like you to take just a couple of minutes and fill out only this portion of the survey under big ideas. And on a scale of 1 to 5, we'd like to know if, based on what you just heard, how well this reflects the community's desired vision for the city of Cedar Park. And please pay special attention to the square for additional feedback. We'd like to know what your other thoughts are, and we'd also like to know if there's what, if anything, you would add. We have a recap up here of what Kat just told us, those big ideas that are straight from the plan, to kind of help you as you work through your survey. And I'll be back in just a couple of minutes to introduce the next speaker. Okay, Tom, I'm going to pick on you a little bit this evening. From what you've heard so far, what are you taking away? What are you going to go home and tell your friends and neighbors?
I see some good ideas here. And I know it's going to take quite an effort to get it all done.
Yeah. We've got just the folks that can do it, though. We sure do. Okay, this next speaker needs no introduction, but he insists on it. So, he is one of those guys that has always taken the road less traveled. And some say that's because he's independent. Some say that's because he's creative. Some say that's because he's ambitious. His wife says it's because he won't ask for directions. He is the director of Parks and Recreation, and he's going to talk about livability. Kurt Randa.
Thank you, Penny. Like Catherine and Brenda, I'm going to take just a few seconds to tell you a little bit about myself before we get started. My wife and I bought our house in Cedar Park in 1995, and in that time we have had 2 dogs, we have purchased 2 homes, and we have graduated 2 sons from Cedar Park High School. Looking back 19 years ago, on why we bought our house in Cedar Park, it wasn't so much about the size of the backyard or the number of cabinets or the amount of closet space. No, we heard kids playing in the neighborhood park, and we saw that there was stores and restaurants coming into Cedar Park every day. And it was sense of community and livability that led us to Cedar Park. Now, if I were to ask each of you why you bought a house here in Cedar Park, most likely your answer would include something on the lines of livability or sense of community. So what is sense of community anyway? Well, if we take it literally from those two terms, sense and community, we can gather that it is certain aspects of a community that appeal to our senses. And then remembering back to third grade science class where we learned what those five senses are, what is it that we can feel and that we can hear and see and smell and taste here in Cedar Park that is attractive to us? Now, answers would obviously differ for everyone, but for me, my favorites are, first of all, feeling that friendly handshake from our new neighbors who moved in across the street, and hearing George Strait when he opened at the Cedar Park Center a few years back, and tasting the fresh seafood at Surf and Turf, or smelling the unmistakable aroma of Moe's brisket. And finally, the wonderful visual display of the Blue Bonnets this spring at Brushy Creek Lake Park. So why is this important? In the latest draft of the comprehensive plan, there are two sections, one on livability and one on public facilities. Now, what that tells us is that both of these are very important to the quality of life here in Cedar Park. And it also tells us that many of you have given us a lot of time to provide your ideas and input in these two areas. What we heard was things like public safety, library, parks, entertainment, and economic development should all play significant roles in helping Cedar Park to be seen as an attractive place. Livability is often referred to as what makes good cities great. And in the comp plan, it is simply referred to as creating places that people want to be. So let's take a look at the public facilities portion of the plan. The overall goal presented in the plan in this section is to maintain our service levels as the city grows. Public safety is a very important factor in assessing a community's quality of life. A high crime rate may actually deter people from moving to our city, and something like an ISO rating of 1, which, by the way, is the highest rating that we have, may attract people to a city. The comp plan indicates that our crime rate here in Cedar Park is half the state average. Now, did my wife and I actually know that the crime rate here in Cedar Park is only 2.1 crimes per 1,000 residents? No, absolutely not. What it was, not so much about the numbers, but it was more of a feeling for us, and we felt safe here. The comp plan indicates planning is currently underway for the expansion of the police station as well as a fifth fire station. Planning is also underway to ensure that both library and parks can maintain their levels of service as the city population increases. When I first moved to Cedar Park, the library had a square footage of 7,000 square feet, and there was one community park, Milburn Park. And currently, the library has 25,000 square feet, and we have four community parks. The library master plan, as well as the parks and open space master plan, are expected to be completed within the year, and both will take an in-depth look at opportunities to maintain those service levels as our population increases. The Cedar Park Center has a capacity of 8,700 people. That's that concert that Kat was talking about, John Legend or George Strait. 8,700 people can fit there. And in our rec center, we can fit 400 people in that facility. The comp plan also identifies as one of our goals the possibility of looking into a medium-sized conference or convention center that might try to hit that sweet spot somewhere in between the capacities of those two facilities. Now, I know, and I saw some of you raise your hands that are employed here, and I know some of you must be in sales. How cool would it be if you were able to meet your coworkers from Phoenix, Austin, Dallas, Omaha? Those people could come here to Cedar Park for your national sales conference, and then maybe after a day of long meetings, you could go to an entertainment venue at the Cedar Park Center where you could take in a Stars or a Toros or an Aces game. So now the overall goal presented in the livability portion of the plan is to ensure that Cedar Park is a desirable and attractive place. Now, when I first started working here for the city, I didn't know a lot about development regulations, and I have since learned how important development regulations are in continuing the quality of life here in Cedar Park. The design of the streets should address safety and mobility, and the pedestrian portion of those designs should provide sidewalks, accessibility, and furnishings, such as possibly outdoor restaurant seating where appropriate. Now, I don't know about you, but for me, if I'm hungry and I'm going to a restaurant and it's nice weather and if it's available, I'm going to ask the maitre d' to seat me outside every time. And then there's also those aspects of this category that are more about what we don't see and hear and smell. Screening and buffering techniques, as well as landscape and signage standards, can go a long ways to provide those opportunities to ensure Cedar Park is seen as a desirable place. And landscaping is not only a way to improve our visual surroundings, but also water-thrifty plant materials can go a long ways towards sustainability. As our drought conditions persist into multiple years now, it's important that the efficient use of our natural resources is incorporated into this plan. Sustainability includes not only ensuring an adequate water supply for our future population, but it also means being able to live in a community from birth to death and seeing facilities and infrastructure that not only last, but may even improve with age. As Catherine mentioned earlier, economic development in Cedar Park has come a long way in a few short years. That being said, there are still many opportunities to attract quality and diverse employers in the areas of technology, innovation, and engineering. And finally, I'm not sure if I mentioned this or not, but the wife I bought the house with in 1995 is the same wife that I have today and is the same wife that I married back in 1985. We've been together for a long time and we have a strong partnership and we have an unofficial motto of better together. We should not forget that partnerships can go a long way in helping make Cedar Park strong. We should work with local and regional partners, such as our school districts, our faith-based organizations, our Chamber of Commerce, and also Austin Community College, the Brushy Creek Regional Utility Authority, the Capital Area Metropolitan Planning Organization, the Lower Colorado River Authority, and Pertinalis Electric Cooperative. I was told not to use acronyms, but you may know those as ACC, BCRUA, CAMPO, LCRA, and PEC. And many others. These partnerships can go a long way in helping Cedar Park achieve our goals and our vision for the future. So 2 years ago, my oldest son graduated from a four-year college out of state, and he got married, and he moved right back here to Cedar Park and bought a house. And my youngest son is now in his third year of college at Texas Tech University and will be starting there actually just next month. So what that means is that my wife and I are this close to being the Butterfields, the empty nesters. So what that means is that within the next few years, we are going to be looking for probably a little bit smaller house. And as I'm not really looking forward to moving again, we have started developing a short list with places that we'd like to move to. And although there are several neighborhoods on that short list, there's only one zip code.
Thank you, Kurt. And every time I write 78613, it's going to have a whole new meaning for me now. Okay, time to take out your surveys again. This time we are interested in the section right here in the center called livability. Based on what you heard so far, And on a scale of 1 to 5, and if you need a pen, raise your hand. We've got pens back here. How well do you think this reflects the community's desired vision for the city of Cedar Park? And in the middle feedback section, what, if anything, would you add along with your other comments? And I'll be right back. Before we go on tonight, there are some members of our community steering committee here. You've heard every speaker up here tonight refer to this group, and I'd like to introduce them. If you'd stand up or wave your hand or jump up and down, sing a song. Bob Ingram. Doug James. There's Doug. Danny Bell. Yes, as in Bell Boulevard. And Ed Trevis. There's Ed. Thank you. There was also a beautiful angel of mercy here tonight who helped me carry some items in when we were doing the big shuffle. She's sitting right there in the center in the black shirt. Thank you again for all your help. I'm going to put you on the spot now. What are you going to go home and tell your friends about what you've heard here tonight? Great, good, glad to hear it, thank you. Okay, our last speaker for the evening. He is a project manager and he works in our engineering department. Yep, you heard me right, he's an engineer. But he has promised to keep it brief no matter how long it takes. His name is Garrett Vaughn.
Good evening, everyone. As Penny mentioned, my name is Garrett Bond. I am going to start with a personal story, but I promise to keep it short. When I first got out of school, I took a job with a consulting firm in South Austin. And hearing all the horror stories about Austin traffic, I got a rental property just down the street from the office. This was a great plan until about a year later when my company moved to an office in downtown. And at the same time, I decided to purchase a house in North Austin. I love my job, but I was finding that in order to avoid traffic on Mopac, I was having to go into work around 6:30 in the morning, come home about 7 at night. Now, this was fine while I was single, but once I got married, I found that I was trying to get home early, spend some time with my wife, and after a long day of work and sitting in traffic for about an hour, my attitude wasn't the best, to say the least. My wife and I talked about it. We finally decided it was time for a change, and I was lucky enough to be offered a position with the Cedar Park. Now I drive up 183 against traffic, and I find that I actually enjoy the drive, and I actually have more time to spend with my wife when I get home at night. Now, that story may have been a little personal, but I just wanted to drive home the point that transportation affects our daily lives. Every day, each and every one of us encounters some form of transportation network. So with a quick show of hands, I just want everybody to show if transportation affected your day in any way, be it positive or negative. So, all right. So based on that, I think we can see transportation is important. Whether you're walking to the Cedar Park Bark Park, kids riding the bus to school, or going to or driving to an important business meeting on Whitestone Boulevard, transportation plays a key role in our everyday lives, and the same goes for a city. An effective transportation network is vital to a city's ability to thrive and grow. Now, if you look at the history of Cedar Park, in the 1970s, neighborhoods were developed with little to no design standards. Typically, the transportation network was just a paved road to get to sellable lots. Now, over time, the development community and home buyers began seeing the benefits of an improved roadway system and drainage system, and this led to improved design standards. Nowadays, most new developments, like the Ranch of Brushy Creek, have roadway networks that include streetlights, drainage systems, landscaped entryways, and sidewalks that connect to schools, amenity centers, parks, and nearby commercial areas. Now, in addition to incorporating these recent development trends, the role of the transportation portion of the comp plan is to identify the top priorities for improving the city's transportation network. The comp plan does not provide project-specific details like new roadways or reconstruction projects. Those are included in the city's transportation master plan, which is also being updated and will be included in the comp plan in the future. But tonight I want to focus on what is covered in the comp plan. As Brenda mentioned, the city of Cedar Park continues to be one of the fastest growing cities in the nation. So planning for new roads and looking for ways to improve efficiency of existing roads is a key objective. Another key priority will be to improve pedestrian connectivity and incorporating innovative design approaches such as a continuous flow intersection, or CFI, that's soon to be constructed at the intersection of Whitestone Boulevard and Palmer Lane. And there have always been concerns about the east-west mobility throughout the city of Cedar Park, with the only primary thoroughfare being Whitestone Boulevard. Thanks to proper planning, we've been able to make improvements to New Hope, Brushy Creek Road, and Park Street recently. However, additional improvements will still be required. And by no means does the plan neglect the north-south mobility, but we're lucky to have a number of major thoroughfares in place to help handle the increased traffic loads. Now, I do want to mention one long-range goal, which is to explore the possibility of adding access roads to 183A, but that is in the future. And one other note on the north-south movement, as Catherine mentioned, Bell Boulevard is the primary thoroughfare into and through the city of Cedar Park and has been since the inception. She referred to it as the backbone. As more homes were built in this corridor, the high visibility and accessibility promoted commercial development. But over the years, traffic volumes have led to congestion, which can have a negative effect on development. One of the final objectives is to look at ways to improve the mobility along the corridor and also look to improve, make it more pedestrian and friendly, thereby increasing the chances for redevelopment. So thanks to the input we've received from the community, the key role of the transportation section of the comp plan is to ensure the City of Cedar Park community, whether it's a teenager, an empty nester, a young family, or a young professional, have a safe and efficient way to get where they're going.
Holy cow, I missed my cue. All right. I have always been told that the mind cannot absorb more than the seat can tolerate. So we need to start wrapping this up. We're going to ask you to turn to your survey one last time. We're looking at this portion called transportation. And again, on a scale of 1 to 5, how well do you think what you just heard reflects the community's desired vision for the city of Cedar Park? And I think we have Garrett's recap up here. All right, good things come to those who plan. Boy, it's good to be in Cedar Park, right? What a great place. Please help us spread the word. We have 2 more meetings just like this one, only we probably won't make them pick up the furniture and move to another building. You can also copy, you can get a, back it up. You can get more information on these two meetings, and you can actually view a copy of the comprehensive plan online at imaginecedarpark.com. As I mentioned earlier, if you didn't get a chance to look at some of the boards that we have posted around the room, we invite you to stay and encourage you to look at those. Especially this one. This one is the action plans. A lot of good information on this one. So be sure to come up in just a minute. Don't everybody run up here at once. But when you get a chance, come look at this one. Our next steps will be to get your feedback, finalize a draft of the plan, and then take that to our city council for their consideration. So in closing, big ideas times livability plus transportation equals good things in our future. Okay, now your survey forms you can put up here on the table or put back there on the little counter back there at the back of the hallway, or you can hand them to any one of us. And who's ready to go home with an iPod Shuffle? All right, come on down, Josh.
Ready for your drawing?
All right. Nothing up my sleeve. Stir. Okay, here we go. So exciting. Number 109-8094. There she is! Congratulations!
All right, before she, before y'all stand up, I do want to make one comment real quick here, because she may be the most deserving person in the room of that iPod Shuffle. She had two lovely children with her who were so quiet in the back tonight and stayed through this entire thing. So let's give her a round of applause.
Again, thank you for sharing a portion of your evening with us. If you need to scoot, we completely understand. If you'd like to ask some questions or a chat with our staff, feel free to mingle around and do so. Thank you.
Thank you. diaper as soon as he's old enough.
Thank you.
Side of the door.
Oh.
Y'all have seen both of the presentations. Mm-hmm. What do you think? Which one do you prefer?
Well, I liked them both,
yeah.
But we had different interests. This was very informative to
the public.
Public, yep. As a whole.
Yeah.
Yep.
But as far as us, yesterday.
Yep.
Well, yeah.
Yeah. The two different,
yeah,
styles.
Well, yeah, yeah, it's so. Because
we had a, you know, big stakeholder yesterday,
yeah,
with a lot of landowners and developers. So we did a much more technical presentation yesterday. Not quite as enjoyable as this one. The graphics were easier.
Well,
and they didn't give anything
you
away.
Both.
And we didn't give anything away, that's right. Oh, I know, I know. I love
you. You should have seen when Garrett, when they announced him an engineer, I went, he looked at me, no, don't.
I'll tell you what, though, and I compliment the city of Cedar Park on city staff and city council for the last 10 years. Well, I can't remember exactly when the bad guys, but no, not really. But the last, okay, no. See, I'm serious. Without the councils that we've had these last, I'd say 10 years, we wouldn't be where we are, because it has definitely been through the council sticking to their guns and saying no to some things and yes to others. Sometimes, you know, it's, everything has little flaws, but I mean, I told Round Rock,
it doesn't pay well, does it?
Yeah, that's a good salary, right? But I got so mad at some of the Round Rock ones that I tell them, I said, you need to go to Cedar Park and take lessons. It's the only city council that you can work with. So, well, Mayor McGraw might have liked it a little bit. We've known him a long time. But I, oh, yeah. other part. It's not the council so much, it's the staff.
Bitching about this water line they're putting across, he said, Roland, you're just like my dad out in East Texas. He said, he's about your age, and he's worried about a road closing or whatever. And he said, you ought to just relax and enjoy life the rest of your life. And I didn't actually say it. I said, well, Mayor, if you want to have some damn stupid construction people out.
And it's not, yeah.
This is an example. This is Ronald Reagan, and this is 272. We're supposed to, and if I said it once, I said it 10 times. Do not leave anything open to where my cattle can get out on the road and get killed. Because I can't handle lawsuits of millions of dollars. I'm still living on my roof. I'm laying poor. So, they're supposed to build a road from point A to point B to keep the cattle in. They start from Ronald Reagan, they start from 272, and they get about 40 yards from each other and they stop the fence. They don't build that. So I jump on this project manager and I said, what's the deal? So he gets his old stack of plans and he flips it over and he says, well, that's where it is now. I said, yeah, what about...